Good morning. Today, with respect to electromagnetic field theory, we'll discuss on boundary condition. Okay. See, in the last class, that is yesterday, we have discussed about something on the fields, okay, wherein we have discussed about the conductors and the current. Okay. So we have defined what is a current and current density. And also we have moved into conductors, wherein we have tried to find out electric field intensity in terms of potential difference we have expressed and so on, and tried finding the resistance with respect to electric field intensity, potential difference. Okay. Knowing that, today we'll move on to boundary conditions. Okay. See, we have learned about conductors. So now we'll see what are the properties of conductors. Okay. And if you take the boundary between conductor and the free space, then what will be the electric field intensity, how to find, and the electric flux density, that is D vector, how to find that, we'll try to do in today's session. So first thing is, we'll see what are the properties of the conductor. Okay. So if you take conductor in electrostatic field, the first property is the static electric field intensity inside the conductor is zero. Okay, if you take a conductor, the field intensity inside the conductor is zero. That is the first property. The second one is the static electric field intensity at the surface, at the surface of a conductor, is everywhere directed normal to the surface. Okay, that means if you take the boundary of the conductor, then the field intensity will be at all points, it will be normal to the surface. That is the second property. Then the third property is the conductor surface is equipotential surface. That means if you try to measure the potential at any point with respect to the same ground, at all points it is of same potential. That's why it is called as equipotential surface. That is the third property of the conductor. And fourth one is the volume charge density inside the conductor is zero. That is rho v equal to zero inside the conductor. In the sense, the net charge is zero. And the fifth one is any net charge will reside only on the conductor surface. Okay. As we have said that there is no charge inside the conductor, that means you will be having only net charge on the surface of the conductor. So these are the properties of the conductor. The first one is the electric field intensity inside the conductor is zero. Okay, that means the net charge inside the conductor is zero. That is the fourth one. Okay, and second one is electric field intensity at the surface is everywhere directed normal to the surface. Okay. In the sense, the conductor surface at all points, it is of same potential, where it is called as equipotential surface. Okay. And any charge will reside only on the surface of the conductor. Okay. These are the properties of the conductor. Knowing these properties, we'll move on. Okay. That means, remember now, only the net charge will be there only on the surface. There is nothing inside the conductor. So we'll move on to the boundary condition, okay, wherein let us consider a boundary between the free space and the conductor. Okay, let us consider this is a conductor and this is the boundary of the conductor. Okay. Above this is the free space and inside this is nothing but the conductor. Okay. So we have taken a boundary wherein above that it is nothing but the free space and inside that is nothing but the conductor. Okay. So over this boundary, okay, we'll try to find out what is the electric field intensity and the electric flux density. Okay. Where the boundary is between the free space and the conductor. Okay. So, in order to find out the electric field intensity, we will try to consider a closed loop. Okay. Around this boundary, we will consider a closed loop. Okay. Similarly, In order to find out the electric flux density, that is D vector, let us consider a Gaussian closed surface. Let us consider a cylindrical, which is nothing but a closed surface. Okay. So suppose on the boundary, if there is an electric field E vector in this direction, then it will have a tangential component and the normal component. Okay. This E vector can be defined in terms of tangential and the normal component. Okay. Similarly, if you take a D vector, it will have a tangential plus normal will result in a resultant D vector. Okay. So we have taken a boundary here. The first thing is, okay, we'll try to find out the electric field intensity. Okay. For that, what we have taken here, it is a closed loop of A named as A, B, C, D. Okay. And here the width of this closed loop is taken as delta W, and the height, very small height, okay, it is tending to zero, height has been taken as delta H, okay, very small height delta H, okay, wherein, as you know, the closed line integral of E vector over a differential length will be equal to zero, okay, that means if you integrate electric field intensity over a closed path, okay, if you integrate the static field over a closed path, it will be equal to zero, okay. So work done in a closed, in fact, you might have come across the work done over a closed path will be equal to zero, okay. So using that, the closed line integral of E dot dl will be equal to zero, okay. Using this, we'll try to find out what are these E component. Okay. So next thing is, around the small closed path, that ABCDA, whatever has been taken a closed loop. Okay. So what the total closed loop of this ABCDA, this closed loop will be split into integral over AB plus integral over BC plus integral over CD. And the last one is integral from D to A. Okay. That split has been shown here, okay, integral A to B, B to C, C to D, and D to A, the line integral of E dot dl, the sum of this is nothing but the closed loop, which will be equal to zero, okay, wherein since electric field intensity is equal to zero within the conductor, okay, like one of the properties we have seen, the electric field intensity inside the conductor is zero. Okay. So hence, what you can see here is, in this figure, okay, this path CD is inside the conductor. Okay. Because of which, integration of the electric field intensity over this path, okay, will be equal to zero, because electric field intensity inside the conductor is zero. Okay. So that is, this third path, that is C to D, E dot dl will be equal to zero. Okay. That means, what is this in turn can be written as, this one is nothing but, it has been considered, we can see in the previous slide, that is in this figure, I've taken this AB, it is nothing but the tangential, okay, tangential path. Along the tangential path, we have considered electric field intensity as ET. Okay. So, this along the path AB, we can write the field intensity as E suffix T, okay, that is tangential component, okay. So ET into delta W, that is the differential length is nothing but delta W, and in along the path B to C, okay, we'll see this along the path B to C, okay. See, the path B to C, it is in the opposite direction to En vector. En vector is considered in this direction, okay, whereas path B is in the opposite direction, okay. So since path B is opposite direction to this En vector, we can take it as minus of, okay. So that has been written here, minus En, because the path is opposite to the whatever we have considered as En. So it will become minus En into half into delta H, okay. Why it is half delta H, not the full delta H? That is because, again, this whole path, half of that may be above the boundary and half of it is below the boundary. below the boundaries, again it is inside the conductor. Inside the conductor, the field intensity is zero. Okay, hence it is only half of delta H. Okay, similarly, in the path C to D, in the path this one, okay, in the path, sorry, D to A, in the path D to A, it is in the direction of electric field intensity. It is in the same direction of En component. Okay, so we can write it as again here this half will contribute nothing, but this half above the boundary will contribute as En by 2 into delta H, or En into delta H by 2. Okay, so here it is plus because this component is in the same direction of whatever has been considered. So here it is plus, whereas this is minus because it is in the opposite direction to whatever has been considered. Hence, the total field intensity can be written as ET into delta W minus EN into half delta H plus EN into half delta H, where sum of this will be equal to 0. Okay. Here we can cancel this minus En delta H by 2 with plus En delta H by 2. So hence it results only as ET into delta W. That is, ET into delta W will be equal to 0. Hence, the tangential field intensity will be equal to 0. That means over the boundary, okay, over the boundary, the tangential electric field intensity will be equal to 0. Okay. That means we know now already the electric flux density. The electric flux density will be equal to permittivity multiplied by electric field intensity. Okay. So electric flux D will be equal to epsilon into E. Since ET is equal to 0, implies what happens? The tangential electric flux density also will be equal to 0. Okay. So ET is 0 implies DT also becomes 0. Okay. So on the boundary, okay, if you consider over the boundary, the tangential field is 0 as well as the tangential electric flux density will be 0. Okay. So this is the boundary between conductor and the free space, where the tangential E field and the tangential electric flux density both will become 0. Now, what we'll try to do is, we'll try to find out the electric flux density, that is normal component of electric flux density. Then we'll try to find out using that electric field intensity of the normal component. Okay. So, to find out the normal component of electric flux density, let us consider the closed surface, that is the Gaussian closed surface. Okay. What is using Gauss law? What the Gauss law tells? The closed surface integral d dot ds is nothing but the charge enclosed. Okay. This is nothing but the Gauss law. The closed surface integral d dot ds is equal to charge enclosed. Okay. What is the closed surface in this figure? Here the Gaussian surface has been considered as the cylindrical surface. Okay. In this cylindrical surface, it has got three faces. Okay. One is the top, second one can be taken as a bottom, and third one is this side face. Okay. The closed surface integral d dot ds can be written as integral over this top surface plus integral over this bottom surface plus integral over the side surface. Okay. So this will be split into, the closed surface integral will be split into integral over top plus integral over bottom plus integral over the side surface. Okay. And as we remember, if you recollect, the field intensity inside the conductor is 0. Hence, if you try to integrate this inside the bottom, then the inside the bottom, the field is 0. That means flux is 0. Hence, this will be, this term will turn out to be 0. Okay. What is remaining now? The first term and the third term. Okay. Again, what happens on the side surface? Side surface, what you have taken, it is nothing but we have a height delta H. Okay. This delta H is tending to zero. It is a very small height. Okay. This delta H is tending to zero. Okay. So considering this delta H, that is this height tending to zero, over the side also integral of this electric field intensity over a differential surface where the surface consists of this height and the height is tending to zero. So hence this term also will result in zero. Okay. So hence what is remaining now? Only that is integral over the top surface d dot ds will be equal to charge enclosed. Okay. So that is in turn implies integral over the top surface d dot ds will be equal to charge enclosed. Okay. The side is zero because the height is very small, which has been considered, and bottom is zero because there is no field intensity inside the conductor. Only the resulting of the closed surface, it is only because of the top. So integral over the top surface d dot ds is nothing but right hand side is same, that is charge enclosed. So what is this d dot ds can be written as? We have taken on the closed surface, okay, in this we have taken a surface area as delta S. We have considered here the surface area, very small incremental surface area delta S. Okay, so along this direction, along this direction, what you have is normal component electric flux density, which is in the normal direction. Okay, so with this can be written as over the top surface, it can be written as dN into delta S. Okay, so over the top surface, this integral d dot ds is nothing but dN into delta S. Okay, and the right hand side is nothing but charge enclosed. Okay, on the boundary, the conductor property we know, it is nothing but it has got the charge, all the charges will be residing only on the conductor surface. Okay, hence the charge enclosed on the surface can be written as surface charge density rho s multiplied by the differential surface area delta s. Okay, that means on this top, okay, from this figure, on this top, that is nothing but the boundary, on this, throughout this we have a surface charge distribution. So the total charge within this surface area will be equal to the surface charge density, that is the distribution, multiplied by the surface area. That gives you the charge within this area. So that is nothing but charge enclosed will be equal to, the charge enclosed will be equal to surface charge density multiplied by the differential surface area. That is dN will be equal to rho s. Normal comp implies if you cancel delta s with delta s, then the normal flux density component is nothing but the surface charge density. Okay, implies if you know flux density, we can find out the electric field intensity. So electric field intensity en will be equal to nothing but this normal component divided by the permittivity. That is, if you take in the free space, that is the permittivity is nothing but epsilon naught. So En will be equal to dN by epsilon naught. What is dN? Rho s. Hence En will be equal to rho s by epsilon naught. So on the boundary, the tangential field will be zero. That means the tangential electric flux density is zero. One more property is the normal component, the flux density is rho s, implies En will be equal to rho s by epsilon naught. Okay, that is dN is nothing but epsilon naught into En, which is nothing but rho s. Okay, now the two things of two boundary conditions are dT equal to ET, which is zero. This is first boundary condition with respect to conductor boundary conditions. Second boundary condition is dN is equal to surface charge density. So these are the two boundary conditions with respect to conductor boundary. Now we'll take some problems based on this whatever has been learnt now, that is the tangential field is zero or the tangential flux density is zero, that is one of the boundary condition, and the normal flux density component is nothing but the surface charge density, and the unit of surface charge density is coulomb per meter square. Okay, so knowing that, we'll consider few problems. So the first example is, given the potential V is equal to 100 into x square minus y square, and point P with coordinates 2 comma minus 1 comma 3 that is stipulated to lie on a conductor, this point P is on the conductor, to free space boundary, find potential V, E vector, D vector, that is flux density, and surface charge density at this point P, and also the equation of the conductor surface. Okay, these are the problems have been asked. Okay, these are the terms we have to find out. So the solution goes like this: potential at point P is nothing but what is V, 100 into x square minus y square. So we just have to substitute what is the x value and y value at point P. So x is equal to 2 and y is equal to minus 1. Okay. Hence, V at point P will become 100 into 2 square, this minus of y is nothing but minus 1. So it will become minus 1 whole square. In turn, this will result with the using the calculation, V at point P will result as 300 volts. Okay. Then, what is the equation representing this? The last part of the question is equation of the conductor surface. That is, what is the conductor surface? It is equipotential surface. Hence, the potential at point P is nothing but 300. So, if you take any point on the surface, it should be having the same potential. So, it is 300 equal to this 100 into x square minus y square, or it can be rewritten as 3 equal to x square minus y square. That is the equation of the conductor surface. Okay. Now, we'll try to find out what is the potential V. Then, next thing, that is E field, D field, and the surface charge density. Okay. So, let us first try to find out what is E vector. Okay. What is this E vector? If you know potential V, we can find out the electric field intensity, because E vector can be written as minus gradient of potential. Okay, that is E vector is equal to minus del V, that is gradient of potential. Okay, what is gradient of potential? It is nothing but differentiation, partial differentiation with respect to x, y, z, and multiplying by respective unit vector. Okay, partial differentiation of potential V with respect to x into ax cap plus dou V by dou y into ay cap plus dou V by dou z into az cap. This is nothing but gradient of potential multiplied by this minus is nothing but the E vector. Hence, we just have to differentiate this, that potential, where the potential what is given in the question is, it is 100 into x square minus y square. By differentiating this with respect to x, it will be only x square differentiation. It becomes 2x. 2x into 100 will become 200x. Okay. So, it will become 2x into 100. Then, differentiation of potential with respect to y will result as what? It is differentiation of this whole thing with respect to y. X is constant now. It becomes 0. Differentiation of y square will become 2y. Okay, so minus is there retained as it is, so it becomes minus 2y. Okay, multiplied by respecting unit vector here ax cap, here it is ay cap. Okay, where so electric field intensity E at point P, by doing this calculation, E at point P can be written as, what is point P? the coordinates have been given as 2, minus 1, 3, that is x, y, z is 2, minus 1, 3 respectively. So in this just substituting the x value as 2 and y value as minus 1, we are getting this answer E at point P, E vector at point P as minus 400 ax cap minus 200 ay cap volt per meter. Okay. Now, knowing this electric field intensity at point P, okay, let us try to find out what is the electric flux density vector at point P. Okay. D vector at point P is nothing but E at point P multiplied by the permittivity of the free space. Okay. So, D vector at point P is epsilon naught into E vector at point P. It has been, we have got here E at point P. Hence, D at point P will be this epsilon naught into this E vector that results in so much nano coulomb per meter square. Okay. Hence, so you knowing this D vector at point P, let us try to find out what is one more thing is the magnitude of this D vector, the magnitude of this D vector, that is root of this component square plus this component square, that is root of 3.54 square plus 1.77 square, will result in this much value, that is 3.96 nano coulomb per meter square. Okay, so one more thing is, we know the surface charge density is nothing but the normal component of electric flux density, that is one of the boundary condition, that is dn is nothing but the surface charge density. Hence rho s, the surface charge density, is nothing but dn, which is nothing but this is the magnitude. Hence rho s will be equal to 3.96 nano coulomb per meter square. Okay, hence we are done with this problem, that is finding V at point P, E vector, D vector and rho s. We'll consider one more example. The second example is given the potential field in free space V equal to 100 sine hyperbolic x into sine phi y volts, and point P is having these coordinates. Find at point P this potential E vector and the magnitude of E vector, and the part D is surface charge density. Okay, what is V at point P? Just direct substitution with what in the place of x, that is 0.1, in the place of y it is nothing but 0.2. So just direct substitution, which will result V at point P as 43.8 volts. Okay, that is just we have to find out sine hyperbolic of 0.1 into sine phi into 0.2. These are in the radians. By putting in the radian mode, we can calculate this, which will result V at point P as 43.8 volts. Okay. Then electric field intensity can be written as minus gradient of potential, which is nothing but just now we have considered in the previous equation. So we can take this, you have just differentiation with respect to S, that is sine hyperbolic differentiation is cos hyperbolic, okay, into phi, because it is 5x into phi is there, and differentiation of this with respect to y will result in sine, will result in cos multiplied by 5. Okay, then by substituting x and y values at point P, E at point P will result as so much value. Okay, then what is the magnitude of E vector? Just finding this one, root of this square plus this square, will result as E at point P magnitude. Okay. And using one of the boundary condition of the conductors, that is surface charge density, is nothing but magnitude of flux density. So we can find out, first thing is dn, that is dn is epsilon into E. Already we have got this E vector, so epsilon multiplied by this magnitude gives you dn vector. By knowing this, what is surface charge density? It is nothing but magnitude of dn vector. Hence surface charge density will be equal to this 44.38 nano coulomb per meter square. Now, We'll see one more term, what is known as dielectrics. Okay, actually, what is a dielectric? It is nothing but it will be having an arrangement of dipoles. Okay, where it will consist of dipoles in the sense some positive and negative charges are separated by a distance. Okay, whose centers will not coincide. Okay, whose the centers will not be same. Whereas these are not free charges, okay, these dipoles are not free charges, but they are called as bound charges. So these bound charges can shift slightly provided by applying a electric field intensity. Okay, that is nothing but a dielectric. Okay, it is nothing but a dipoles which are having not a free charges, but they'll have a bound charges. These bound charges will shift their orientation by applying a electric field intensity. In turn, using that, we can determine the conductivity. Okay, so let us try to consider the boundary for these dielectrics. Okay, where dielectrics means there are no free charges, they are only bound charges. Let us consider the boundary condition for this perfect dielectric material. Okay, let us take a boundary. Okay, where the boundary, it is between the two dielectrics. Okay, consider the interface between two dielectrics. Okay, wherein one of the dielectrics is having a permittivity as epsilon 1. Okay, and the second dielectric is having a permittivity epsilon 2. Okay, so we have taken a boundary between two dielectric. One is having the permittivity epsilon 1, one more is having the permittivity epsilon 2. Okay, so here, in order to find out something similar to the previous boundary condition, to find out the tangential components, let us consider a closed path. Okay, and in order to find out the normal components of E field or flux density, consider a closed surface which is Gaussian surface. Okay, so we can recollect the closed line integral E dot dl is equal to 0. The work done that with considering the over a closed surface will be equal to 0. Okay, so around this small closed path, which is nothing but can be split into the tangential field plus this normal component, plus this tangential component, plus this normal component. Okay, so over the boundary, that is in the region 1, the field intensity is taken as E tan 1. Okay, in the region 2, the field intensity, the tangential field, has taken as E tan 2. Okay, so using that, E tan 1 in this direction, it is E tan 1 into delta W, minus in this opposite direction, it is in the opposite direction inside the second region, but E tan 2 is taken in this direction, but we are moving in the opposite direction over this closed path. So it becomes here minus E tan 2 into delta W. Okay, similarly, in this direction, if you take a normal component, the normal component in this direction is minus, because dn1 has been considered in this direction, but en1 will be in the opposite direction, so it is minus. Minus en1 into, in this direction, it is my delta h is the height, and in this direction, it is in the direction of normal component, so here it is plus. Okay, for the en2, so it is plus en2 into this height. Again, it is a very small height, delta h. Okay, sum of these is will be equal to 0, because this closed line integral is equal to 0. Okay, but here what can be observed here is this third term and the fourth term, since we have considered this height, the delta h, which is a very small height, which is tending to 0, hence this one will not contribute anything much. This will be taken as approximately 0. Similarly, this term also will be taken, this delta H is approaching, attending 0. And these two terms are 0. So what is remaining now? Only the first and the second term, that is this term and the second term, this one. Hence, it can be written as E tan 1 into delta W minus E tan 2 delta W equal to 0, or E tan 1 into delta W will be equal to E tan 2 into delta W. Okay. So delta W is the same width both the sides, we can cancel this. Hence, E tan 1 will be equal to E tan 2. Okay. So this is the first boundary condition with respect to dielectrics. So this E tan 1 can be written as with respect to electric flux density and the permittivity. This E tan 1 can be written as D tan 1 by epsilon 1. Similarly, E tan 2 can be written as D tan 2 by epsilon 2. Hence, E tan 1 equal to E tan 2 is same as writing D tan 1 by epsilon 1 equal to D tan 2 into epsilon 2. Okay. That means this tangential component are continuous across the boundary, whereas electric flux density, the tangential component, are discontinuous over the across the boundary. Now, we'll try to figure out one more boundary condition with respect to the normal component. For that, we'll apply the Gauss law over this small surface that is we have considered as a cylindrical surface. Okay. So, using Gauss law, the closed surface integral d dot ds is nothing but the charge enclosed. Okay. So, the closed surface integral can be split into surface integral over the top surface plus the surface integral over the bottom plus surface integral over the side. Sum of this is nothing but the right hand side, the same thing, charge enclosed. Okay. But this side surface, again, we can observe in this figure, this side surface has taken a height of delta H. Okay. And the height of this pill box or the cylindrical surface is approaching 0. It is tending 0. Hence, the integral over this closed surface, that is mainly on the side surface, it will not contribute anything much. So, it will be equal to, this term will be equal to 0. Okay. Now, what is remaining? This surface integral d dot ds plus, that is top and the bottom. This third term is 0. Now, the top is nothing but can be written as dn1 into delta s, and the bottom can be written as minus dn2 into delta s. Why it is minus? Because inside, okay. What is flux density? We have taken electric flux density in this direction. We have taken electric flux density in this direction, that is dn2. Okay. But you are taking the integral over this surface, okay, which will be in the opposite direction. Okay. So what we have considered is in this direction, but flux density here will be acting, will be in the opposite direction. Hence, it will become minus the dot product of the flux density with the differential surface area will result in the opposite. So, it is in minus because the differential surface vector will be in this direction. The normal component is this direction. Differential surface area vector in the opposite direction. So, the dot product will result in minus. Okay. So, that is you will have an dot minus an dot vector. So, it will become minus. Okay. So, it is dn1 into delta s minus dn2 into delta s will be equal to charge enclosed. Okay. What is charge enclosed? We can write it as the surface charge density multiplied by the differential surface area. Okay. Over the boundary, what are the surface charge density multiplied by the differential surface area? But one thing we have to recollect, over the dielectrics we don't have any free charges, everything is the bound charges. Okay. Since there are no free charges, this surface charge density will be equal to 0. Hence, this right hand side term will be nothing but it will be equal to 0. Hence, this dn1 into delta s minus dn2 into delta s will be equal to 0. Or otherwise, we can call it as dn1 equal to dn2. Implies what can be written as epsilon 1 in terms of electric field intensity, this can be written as epsilon 1 into En1, which will be equal to this one, epsilon 2 into En2. Or En by En1 divided by En2 will be equal to epsilon 2 by epsilon 1. Okay. This is a second boundary condition, that is normal D component is continuous whereas normal E vector component are discontinuous. Okay. So these are the two boundary conditions. The first boundary condition is the tangential electric fields are equal. The second boundary condition is normal flux density components are equal. That is, the first one is E tan 1 equal to E tan 2. The second one is dN1 equal to dN2. So these are the two boundary conditions with respect to dielectric surface. Okay. So now we'll consider one case, that is the refraction of D vector at this dielectric interface. Okay. Let us consider a boundary between two dielectrics with the region 1 having the permittivity epsilon 1. In the region 2, the dielectric constant, let us consider as epsilon 2. Okay. So over the boundary, there is an electric flux density D2 vector, which is incident by considering this as a normal, it is incident at an angle of theta 2. Okay. Now, after incident, this D2 vector, it has got refracted, that is with as called in the region 1 as D1. Okay. And the refractive angle, let us consider it as theta 1. Okay. So incident angle is theta 2 and the refracted angle is theta 1. Okay. That means this D2 vector can be considered in terms of tangential, let us write it as dN d tan 2, and the normal component of this D2 vector we consider it as dN2. Similarly, for this vector, dN1 vector can be written as this as tangential component d tan 1 and this as normal component dN1. Okay. That means using this figure, what is dN1 can be written as, what is dN1 can be written as, which is this, with respect to this angle theta 2, it can be written as this D2 into cos theta 2. This dN2 can be written as D2 into cos theta 2. Similarly, what is D1 can be written, or dN1 can be written as this. dN1 can be written as D1 into cos theta 1. This component can be written as D1 into cos theta 1. Okay. So, and using the boundary condition, we know that dN1 equal to dN2. Hence, D1 into cos theta 1 will be equal to D2 into cos theta 2. Okay. Similarly, we know one more condition, that is of the boundary condition, that is E tan 1 equal to E tan 2, or D tan 1 by D tan 2 is equal to epsilon 1 by epsilon 2. Okay. What is D tan 1? Something similar to this dN1, something similar to this D tan 1 can be written as D1 into sin theta 1. From this figure, this tangential component can be written as D1 into sin theta 1. Similarly, this d tan 2 in terms of this angle d theta 2 and d2 vector can be written as d2 into sin theta 2. Okay. So, d tan 1 by d tan 2 can be written as d1 into sin theta 1 divided by d2 into sin theta 2, which will be equal to epsilon 1 by epsilon 2. Okay. So, let us consider this one, previous one, as equation 1. And this one resultant as, by just cross multiplying this with this, that is this one as equation number 2. Okay. So we have this equation number 1, this as equation number 2. So we'll do now 2 divided by 1. Okay. That is sine by cos and sine by cos. Okay. What will this result as? Sine by cos. So that will result as tan theta 1 divided by tan theta 2 will be equal to epsilon 1 by epsilon 2. Okay. Hence, this is one of the important results. Using this, we can find out, knowing these angles, we can find out the permittivity, or knowing the permittivity of the two regions, we can, yeah, knowing either the incident or the refracted angles, we can find the either of one. Okay. One more result, that is D2 vector can be written as DN2 into AN cap plus DT2 vector into AT cap. Okay. That is, what is DN2? Just now we have in the previous, this DN2 can be written in terms of the first one, that as D1 cos theta 2. Okay. It has been substituted here. This DN2 is nothing but D1 cos theta 1. What is D2? DT2 can be written in terms of D1. This DT2 can be written in terms of D1 as this epsilon 2 by epsilon 1 into D1 sin theta 1. Okay. Using this equation 2. Okay. So that is D1 sin theta 1 into epsilon 2 by epsilon 1. This is nothing but DT1. Okay. So this D2 vector can be written in terms of D1, the normal component and the tangential component, something like this. Okay. So D2 vector, you can find out D2 vector in terms of this D1, that is D2 vector can be written as, for magnitude of this D2 vector is nothing but root of this normal component square plus this tangential component square. Okay. That is D1 cos theta 1 square plus this component whole square. So D1 has been taken outside the square root, inside it is D1 square taken out. So it is D1 into root of so much. Okay, this is the magnitude. Okay. So by knowing this D2, we can find out what is known as E2. Okay. So because D2 can be written as epsilon 2 into E2. And D1 can be written as epsilon 1 into E1. Okay. So by taking here this epsilon 1 and this side, if you cross multiply here, it will become epsilon 1 by epsilon 2. Okay. So that epsilon 1 by epsilon 2 taking inside this square root, this equation can be written in terms of electric field intensity as E2 magnitude as E1 into root of sine square theta 1 plus epsilon 1 by epsilon 2 whole square into cos square theta 1. Okay. So you can write, knowing this D1, we can find out D2, or similarly, knowing this E1, we can find as E2. Okay. So these are the some of the important result where if you know this refracted component, you can find out the incident, or if you know incident, we can find out this refracted components using these few important results. That is this one, one is this one, tan theta 1 by this, and one more is this D2 and E2 components. Okay. So further, we'll try to consider one problem. Let me consider one problem. That is, let the region Z less than 0 be composed of uniform dielectric material for which epsilon r is 3.2, while the region Z greater than 0 is characterized by epsilon r equal to 2. Okay, there are two regions. One is having permittivity 3.2. One more region is having permittivity 2. And the figure is given with D1 vector incident like this. Okay, and the D2 vector which has taken refracted, this is the incident angle and this is the refracted angle. Okay, some of these three few terms we have to find out. Okay, that is dn1 component and dt1 component and so on. Okay, let me take few terms here. What is dn1? Okay, since it is the boundary at z equal to 0 surface, okay, the normal component is nothing but it is in the direction of az cap. Hence this d1 vector will result, this 70 az cap is nothing but the normal component, remaining are nothing but the tangential component. Okay, so this dn1 is nothing but the normal component, implies remaining is nothing but the tangential component. Okay, so third part is magnitude of this, which we can find out using this vector. Then knowing this tangential component, okay, you can find out what is called d1. Okay, and The next part is we have to find out these angles, okay? Those relations are there where d1 into cos theta 1 can be written as dn, okay? Using that, we can find out this angle theta, which will result around 39.79 degrees, okay? Then dn1 is not same as dn2. Hence, we have got in the problem they have given, they have mentioned dn1. Hence, dn2 will be nothing but 70 az cap, or the magnitude is nothing but 70. Okay. One more result is there, that dt1 by dt2 is nothing but epsilon 2 by epsilon 1. Using that result, already dt2 is there, we can find out dt1 or dt2. Okay. Hence, d2 vector is nothing but the tangential plus normal component. Having got this dt2 and dn2, we can find out this using this component and this component, we can find out d2 vector. Okay. So once we get d2 vector, we know the result, that is dn2 can be written as d2 into cos theta 2. Okay. So this normal component is there. Using that, we can find out this angle theta 2, which is nothing but cos inverse of this normal component divided by this d2, that is this magnitude, this whole magnitude. So theta 2 will be equal to 27.5 degrees. Okay. So in this problem, whatever there here, the previous result, this equation, this one, and these boundary condition, using these boundary condition, we have tried solving this problem. Okay. So further, in next few classes, we'll consider, in one of the class, we'll try to consider the more example based on this normal component and the tangential components, where you have, if you have an incident, how to find out the refracted component, and there the normal component and the tangential, and also we'll try to find out this incident and the refracted angles. Okay. So we'll consider more problems in next few classes. Okay.